Hebrews chapter 4. Appreciate that. Hebrews chapter 4. Let's look in, let's see here, verse 14. We're going to kind of get the gist of it. Hebrews is a wonderful teaching book on understanding how Jesus fulfills the Old Testament. How he fulfills the office of high priest, how he fulfills the position or the part of the sacrifice, how his blood is represented by the blood of the Lamb in the Old Testament, how the sacrifices represented his sacrifice on the cross and so on, and why he came down here the way he did. Could God have just saved us from heaven without coming down? I don't know the answer to that. I just know that God chose to send his only begotten son down here, born as a man, to live the life that you and I live. Do I believe he cried as a baby? Absolutely. He cried as a man. Jesus wept. Do I believe that he was hurt like little boys get hurt? I'm sure he did. He was hurt on a cross. And the Bible says that he went through everything that we go through, including the death of loved ones, knowing that they would be resurrected. But he wept anyway. And so verse 14 says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. That means don't walk away from your profession that to the world. And don't be ashamed anymore. Say it. I'm a Christian. I'm born again. I'm going to heaven when I die. I'm a sinner saved by grace. Don't be ashamed anymore. Amen. Verse 15. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. You know, that's some people's opinion of preachers and pastors and priests. They're not in touch with the real world because they never do anything wrong and they're better than everybody else, or they perceive they're better than everybody else, or some people think that their pastor is better than everybody else. God did not give you a pastor here at this church that's better than you. I guarantee you. So in that likeness, we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. And in this case, our infirmities are sin. But was in all points. How many points? All. Tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Verse 16. Now he's not telling us that we are going to be like Christ, that every time we get tempted, we're not going to sin. He is not telling us that, because you can see it in the next verse. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of what? Grace, that we may obtain what? Mercy is the forgiveness of sins. Mercy, and find grace to help in time of need. So this morning, I'm going to, again, I want to direct this in the direction of our men. Men, I want you to consider the world that we live in right now. Consider how easily sin doth beset us in this world we live in right now. It's easy to sin. What's difficult is to resist temptation. It's not easy. And Christ gave us an example to follow. And thank God that we not only have a way, I'll get to this in a minute, we not only have a way of escape before the sin to keep us from sin, but we have a throne of grace and mercy that if or when we fail, we can still go back to our great high priest and find forgiveness. Somebody say amen. Father, we ask your blessings on this message. Lord, I, again, Father, I feel good today. That's probably not going to be a good message, because I'm afraid, Lord, it'll be too much of me and not enough of you. So, Father, I must decrease so that you can increase today. Bless your word today. Bless it for these people's sakes. Do it for them, Father, and do it for your name's sake. We pray in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. Temptation. Now, when the Bible says that he was in all points tempted like as we are, let's take our Bibles. I'm going to end up in Matthew chapter 4. You might want to turn there. When we get there, I'm going to make some comparisons. I've done this before. I've taught this before, but maybe not everybody's heard it. By the way, it's good to have our family back. I can't. You're with Kyle, right? I remembered that. And yours was Madison. Madison. Okay. Is she good medicine for you, Kyle? She's a nurse. Hey. I was speaking by inspiration of the Holy Ghost. Amen. But I'm going to make some comparisons between what Adam and Eve went through and what Christ went through. And the Bible is full of that. Everything that failed in the Old Testament, Christ accomplished in the New. James chapter 1, verse 2, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse, that's what that word means, it's not skydivers or pool divers, it's diverse temptations. So number one, you are not going to leave this world untempted and untested and untried. By the time Christ calls your name or he appears in the air, you will be battle-hardened and fit and ready as God will make you. That's how you're going to be. Those of you who were in the military or know anything about it, you know what I'm talking about. We don't just put guys out on the battlefield who don't know anything. We try to train them in every possible scenario that they can find. But the real test, the real training is in the battlefield, is it not? Those boys that were so eager to jump off of those boats on D-Day, June 6, 1944, as they were watching some 3,000 men lay dead on the beach of Omaha Beach there in Normandy, France. Those boys who were not battle-tested, who were not battle-hardened, who at the sight of the blood of their comrades or the death of their comrades, they ended up against that cliff shaking in fear. It took those who had already seen their comrades fall, who had already seen the sight of blood of their friends and their fellows and of themselves. Many of those guys were wounded and refused to go back home. They said, we're going to fight. And they encouraged those younger soldiers who had not endured this, had not been through it. Get up. We're going to win this day. We're going to defeat these guys. We're going to get off of this beach. And they did. So, brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. This is God testing you. This is God making you into a man. I mentioned a little while ago when we brought Lindsay home after she was born. She's our firstborn. And how God decided to make a man out of me that night when she quit breathing. I mean, it did. It scared me to death. And I can look back at events that have happened in my children or my grandchildren's life that has shaped me and molded me into what I am today. And I am not what I want to be today. I'm not. I'm a long way from it. But I'm not who I was years ago. Nowhere near that. And all of that was done through God's tempting and trials and getting me battle hardened. So I can say, I've been through this. I know what this is. This will pass. God will get you through it, but you're going to be different on the other side. So James chapter 1, verse 12, he said, blessed is the man that endureth temptation. So you pray not to be tempted, but God says there's a blessing when you endure it. It's a blessing. They say that there's some sort of blessing that you get by exercising. I don't know what that would be. Bodily exercise profiteth little, but it does profit. Amen. And the analogy there was not don't exercise. It means think of exercising yourself spiritually. Get your spiritual muscles tightened and firm. So he said, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. And by the way, did Jesus, was he tried? Was he tempted? Okay. Did he receive a crown of life? He died. But did he get a crown of life? Yeah, he lived. He rose again. Let no man say, watch this, when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. Now, this is where we have to stop. Take your Bible, turn to Genesis 22. Because when I was in Bible college, they used to like to point out what they felt were contradictions in the Bible. Where the Bible, they, in their opinion, wasn't translated correctly, or where the Bible might have contradicted itself. And that was a way for them to say, you can't trust any translation of the Bible because all translations have faults in them. We must go to the original Hebrew and Greek and so on. Raise your hand if you know Hebrew. Raise your hand if you know Greek. I know that much. I can read the words and know some of them. But I couldn't read it, speak it, say it. Couldn't talk in it. So the only thing I have is my English Bible. And if my English Bible isn't right, I'm in trouble. Because it looks like here there's a contradiction. Up there on the screen, it says, let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. And yet when you look in Genesis 22 verse 1, it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham. Uh-oh. We had a mistake. We'd have an error in our Bible. No, sir. The two definitions of the word temptation, you got to get the context. You got to read. You got to read what you're talking about, and or you'll look stupid. Amen. Know what you're talking about, or you just look foolish in front of everybody. When you say, "Well, that means there's contradictions in the Bible, and that's poorly translated," it should rather say something else. No, it says what it says. Two definitions of the word tempt: a person can be tempted with sin. And God never tempts us to sin. He don't have to. He's got a devil for that. And the devil will tempt us with sin. God tempts us in that he tries us. One of my favorite books in the Bible is 1 Peter. Because it speaks of all through it that we will go through a fiery trial, which is to try us. And it's not trying our works. It's testing our faith. Do we still believe? In other words, when the doctor comes in and says, we know what's wrong with your little boy. He has cancer. He has leukemia, and he's very sick. Will you still trust God? You didn't have any choice. You didn't have no choice. You had no way to go. Was God faithful? Always is. Always is. And we walk through those trials and those temptations, weeping, hurting, afraid, lonesome. And yet God's with us all along. And then years later, we look back and we say, God, thank you for doing that. Thank you for that. See, that's what James meant. Said, brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. Now, it's not joyful going through it. It's joyful on the other side of it. Okay? So that's the difference right there. God does not tempt with sin. Let a man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil. God cannot, you cannot, the devil doesn't flash pictures of women to God and say, hey God, would you like this? God's like, get away from me. Okay? Nor does God do that to us. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Amen. He wants everybody righteousness. God is not pleased at the death of the wicked, the Bible says. So he says, let a man say when he's tempted, I'm tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man, here we go, is tempted. It's automatic. It's on autopilot. You are tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. The temptations already lie in you. You are full of lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. You're full of that. That's why I said this morning in the prayer, I mean it. When I feel good, boy, I tell you what, I want to walk around. I want to really preach and make myself known. And that's usually not a good thing. It means there's probably more of me in this message today than there needs to be. So I want God to decrease me and increase himself for your benefit. Because I can get pride of life just like anybody else can. I can get lust of the flesh like anybody else can. And I keep bringing this up because it's part of my study right now. But those poor Catholic priests who were told, I'm being gracious this morning to men who are lost that Christ died for. The Catholic priest is a man that Christ died for. He was told and promised that when he made his vows to God to be a priest, God would withdraw all lust from him and he would serve God faithfully. It would be a gift to give him celibacy, that he never needed to have a wife. He was lied to by a corrupt religious machine. He was lied to. And so that man has no choice but to live in sin for the majority of his life. He has no choice. Because he is drawn away of his own lust. When lust hath conceived, verse 15. Notice these are birthing words. When lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. Sin's a baby that's born. Sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Our sins, men, will kill our relationship with our wives. Our pride will. Our lust will. It'll destroy our relationship with our families. It'll destroy a church. Can one man's sin in a church affect the entire church? It did in the days after they fought the Battle of Jericho. When Achan took from Jericho that which he was told not to touch. He lusted after it, lust of the eyes. He lusted after having it, the lust of the flesh. And he stole the Babylonian garment because he would look good in it. The problem is he would never be able to wear it in front of anybody. Because they would say, where'd you get that at? Walmart in Egypt? Costco? Who are you going to tell that to? And he lost his life and they ended up killing his family over it too. One man said, and I, for some reason, I prayed about this the other day. It came into my heart. I don't know why. And I don't need to know, don't want to know. But I prayed because maybe God just said, Mike, pray this and we'll ward it off. But the issue that somebody might be among us living in deep sin and hiding it well. That happens, you know. It happens. And for just for some reason, God brought that in my heart, and I prayed and said, God, just deliver whoever it is. If there is anybody, I don't know anything. I don't. But even me saying, I don't know anything, some people get nervous. They're going, he knows something. No, I promise you I don't. But I do want you to think I do, all right? Now turn to Matthew 4. I do want you to be scared every now and then. That's good for you, amen? It's good for you to get scared. Isn't it, my daughters? I had a thing where they would be in their bathroom fixing their hair in the morning or brushing their teeth or whatever. And I would, they'd leave the bathroom door open. I'd slip by the bathroom. I'd go down the hall a little bit and I'd sneak back, come around that door and go, boom, like that. Ah! And they'd go, Dad! Ugh! And they got to where when they see me go by, they just stop. And I got to where I waited a long time. Because you can only stand there so long with a toothbrush, right? Anyway, this. All right, now Matthew 4. Adam and Eve. I've mentioned this before. When Adam and Eve sinned, they were tempted exactly the way Christ was tempted, with lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. When Eve saw that it was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and it was desired to make one wise, she ate and she gave to her husband and he did eat. Now, was Eve hungry? No. She was living, Brother George, in a garden full of free food. She had carrots, celery, mushrooms, cabbage, cheese, okra, corn, wheat. She could have made cornmeal and stuck that okra in there and fried that up and had dinner. Amen. I love fried okra. Amen. They had apples, oranges, pears, strawberries, kumquats, peaches. They had everything growing in that garden and could have eaten free. They had the tree of life they could have eaten from and did. So she wasn't even hungry. And she easily fell into that sin, didn't she? I mean, she didn't dwell on it for days and fight and struggle and say, God, I don't want to. God, I don't want to do this, but it's drawing me. I mean, boom, ate the fruit. When she gave it to Adam, Adam didn't fight her. He said, he's probably like, boy, I've been looking at that like you have. They fell into it easily. Now, Christ, this is different. Look at Matthew chapter 4, verse 1. Then when Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. This was all planned. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and he was afterward and hungered. Now you fasted for 40 days, and you are starving to death, and the devil offers you a chance to make bread. Not stale bread, fresh, baked, hot, buttered bread. How can you turn that down? But he did. Adam and Eve had a belly full, but they fell easily into temptation. They had everything and they wanted more. And they thought they were getting it through that fruit. And yet Jesus now is not eaten for 40 days, and he isn't hungered. And so the tempter came to him, verse 3, and said, if thou be Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Now, I'm going to go to these verses. If you've got your Bible open, which you should, You should get a pen out, and right next to this, write Deuteronomy 8, because that's where the verse comes from. What is Jesus doing to survive the temptation that he's enduring? Quoting scripture. That's all he's doing. He's quoting it. He's not trying to say it in a magical way to make it do some mystical, magical, awesome thing. He's just quoting scripture. It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. So in Deuteronomy 8, we find this verse. Deuteronomy 8, 3, and he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger. Who did that? God did. God, listen, this country, we got food everywhere, but it could be taken away from us. The talk this weekend was, it's cheaper to buy the chickens than it is eggs now. Taken away from us, but we got plenty of food here. Maybe here he's not talking about physical hunger. He's talking about spiritual hunger. And I'm going to tell you, brothers, when you've done without God and without the Word of God feeding you for long enough, you'll come back for it. Amen. Or, watch this, the devil will offer you an alternative. And you're going to have to decide, which one do I want the most? Do I want the devil's food or do I want angel's food? Amen. Because that's what manna is. It's angel's food. It's the Word of God. He humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy fathers know, that he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread only, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live. Amen. You see, Jesus is telling us the only power that we have against the tempter is with the Word of God. And that Word of God must be open. That Word of God must be present. I'm not saying you got to read it out loud. I'm not saying you got to declare it to the world. I'm just saying have the Word of God with you. Amen. Have it in your mind. Have it in your heart. Have it in your lap or your hand. Have it in your mouth. However you choose to do it. But you will not succeed without the Word of God. Matthew chapter 4 verse 5. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple. And saith unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down. For it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Turn to Psalm 91. Because that's where that comes from. The devil, watch this now. The devil's, seems like he's adjusting his tactics. He's like, oh, he gave me scripture. Well, I'm going to give him scripture. The problem is, and you, I want you to, should I preach this? Not every place that's called church is a place that you should be in. The devil gave scripture back to Christ, and he quoted it pretty much accurately, but the context that he put it in left out the context that it was in, making it sound like that he could just jump off of some high place and automatically angels would come and get him. Now, I've never seen this, but in places, Eastern Kentucky, East Tennessee, West Virginia, we know that there are churches that use snakes in their worship service, real, live rattlesnakes. Because that said in the scripture that if they're bitten by a serpent, they'll not have any harm done to them.
So in my opinion,
they are tempting God by forcing God to heal them when they very ignorantly picked up a rattlesnake. I do not need scripture to tell me don't pick up a rattlesnake. I have never in my life, I am proud to say I have never one time picked up a rattlesnake. Amen. But they do it. And many of them have died. Some of them who have done it so much, they do develop a resistance to the venom. And they say, see, it's God, it's the power of God. I've been bitten, look at here, I've gotten bitten, nothing's happening. But then somebody else, some kid does it, and they die. I think that's wrong, amen. And the devil took this out of the context that it was in. Psalm 91, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. And here you have the person who is seeking refuge from God. He's not running toward his enemies. He's not running toward, what does he say he's going to put under our feet? The young lion and the adder and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. That person is not running toward the dragon saying, God said I'm going to trample you under my foot. God said that I'm going to do that. No, the person went and hid themselves in God first and was covered by God. What was it that Joshua did after Achan stole the things from Jericho that he did? He went foolishly and blindly into the next city, Ai, to take it, thinking it's a done deal, it's automatic. I don't even have to ask God for this. He's going to give me victory. He come back with his tail tucked between his legs, didn't he? Lost a few thousand men that day. And he spent time weeping, and God finally picked him up. Joshua, get up. Quit that crying. That was done, and you know why. There's sin in the camp, and I am not going to bless you until you get rid of it. Besides that, you went in without asking me first. Next time you ask. Amen? That's the context that the devil took it out of. But then Jesus said unto him back in verse 7 of Matthew 4, it is written again, devil, you twisted the scripture. And I'm gonna counter your attack with another scripture. Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Now, that's Deuteronomy 6. Turn there. While you're turning there, let me tell you what I think that means in let's say, one application. There could be multiple meanings. But a man that will say, you know, I'm saved. It ain't nothing I can do to lose my salvation. So I'm going to have me multiple mistresses. I'm going to hook up with teenage girls on the internet. In fact, I might even get me a boy every now and then. I'm going to live the life of sin and rebellion to God. And God must save me and still take me to heaven. You are tempting God, my friend. And you can't tempt God and get away with it. Deuteronomy 6:16, you shall not tempt the Lord your God as ye tempted him in Massah. You shall diligently keep the commandments of the Lord your God and his testimonies and his statutes which he commanded thee. And thou shalt do that which is right and good in the sight of the Lord, that it may be well with thee, and that thou mayest go in and possess the good land which the Lord sware unto thy fathers, to cast out all thine enemies from before thee, as the Lord has spoken. God's told them, he said, you tempted me in Massah. I let it go. Don't you dare tempt me again. I won't be so kind and forgiving the next time. Now I've warned you. Now I'm telling you, you stick to that Bible. You read that thing. You memorize it. You know the commandments of God. You know what's right and wrong. You know the testimonies of God, those stories in the Bible that teach us right from wrong. You know those things. Then I'll give you that good land that I promised you. But don't think for a minute that just because you're Jews or just because you're the people of God that I owe you this land. And you know what? Not a one of them that came out of Egypt entered into Canaan land except Joshua and Caleb. Not even Moses did. That'll tell you something about tempting God, won't it? God said, don't do it. Matthew chapter 4 again, verse 8. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And he saith unto him, all these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. You know, when I was a kid, I used to think, well, yeah, he should have done that. Because then Jesus would have had all the kingdoms of the world. Boy, was I dumb. I thought my sister would say amen to that. I guess she knows she can't outrun me today. Again, the devil taketh him up to an exceeding high mountain, showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And he saith unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. That's the devil's plan right there. He has tipped his hand and showed you his cards. Y'all know what that means, don't you? If you played poker or goldfish, you don't show people your hand. You don't. But the devil's tipped his hand. He has revealed himself and his nature, not only to Christ, but to all of us who believe the Word of God. It's all about everybody worshiping him, isn't it? That's why he's tempting you, isn't it? Because he knows if he can tempt you with enough sin, that you will live that life and stay in that life because you won't have a choice anymore. And your whole life will be spent doing whatever the devil tells you to do. Brother Ron DeGonia has a wonderful testimony. Some of you know him. He said there came a time in his life when the devil, he's sitting in a jail cell. And the devil jumped on him and said, Ron, I can make you do whatever I want you to do. And Ron said, that scared me. That scared me. So then Jesus saith unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. By the way, worship is serving. You do this. Look at all the places in the Bible where it says worship, and multiple times you'll see worship and serve. Worship and serve. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou. Worship is serving. Serving God. What we call, when we come in here and sing and play these instruments, we call that worship. It may be to some extent, because the Bible says to sing in psalms and hymns, spiritual songs, singing, making melody in our hearts to the Lord. Clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with his voice. Lift up a joyful noise. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Praise him with cymbals and harps. Praise him with the high-sounding cymbals and all of those things. Praise him with the instruments. Yeah, I get that. But to really worship God means to serve him, and you do what he tells you to do. Amen. Worship means worth-ship. You are showing that God is worthy of you serving him. Amen. But a lot of times people get it backwards and say, boy, God really got something when he got me. I'm here to tell you, God, you picked the right man for the job. I'm the guy. I'm going to change the whole church. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. Turn to Deuteronomy 10. That's where I believe he quoted from. In fact, there was a couple places that I was going, well, maybe that was it. Deuteronomy 10:20. Thou shalt fear the Lord. Let's read that. Let's read what Jesus said. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Deuteronomy 10:20, thou shalt fear the Lord thy God, and him shalt thou serve. I say that's close enough. And to him shalt thou cleave and swear by his name. See, the thing is, every time Christ quoted the scriptures, they were all three from the same book. Deuteronomy, fifth book of the Bible. Five is a number for grace. It's one of the meanings of it. And victory over death is another meaning of it. A similar verse, Exodus 34:14, for thou shalt worship no other god, for the Lord whose name is jealous is a jealous God. Is he not? So can you serve the devil by doing what he says and serve God at the same time? No man can have two masters. Either he will hold to the one and despise the other, or cleave to the one and hate the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. You cannot have two masters. You're going to have to decide whose side you're going to be on and what coach you're going to listen to. Amen? Put on a uniform of whatever team you're going to play with, and then go play it. But don't try to play both sides of it. Somebody say amen. And what that is when we tempt God, we think that we can live a life of sin or dabble in sins and God will still forgive me. That's one of the devil's best tricks that he's got. Oh, God will always forgive you. So go ahead and do that again. God will forgive you afterward. Don't worry about it. Yeah? If you can stand the beating that he's going to give you for thinking that for a few minutes. Somebody say amen to that. Because I guarantee you, if God loves you the way he loves me and the way he loves his children, if you start thinking that way, well, I know God will forgive me after I get done with this, and then I'll put it away, and I won't mess with this anymore, and I won't be part of this anymore. God will take a rod to you and whoop the fire out of you for thinking that way. You ought to ask me how I know. I know. Amen. I got a lot more scriptures here for you. I know it's a little bit late, but... And no, I keep saying, I was thinking about it yesterday. I've been pastoring since 1996 here in this building. At what point can you ever remember me letting you out at noon? I don't know. So I guess by default, we're not a noon o'clock church anymore. We're a noon 30. That'll make it feel better for you if I let you out before 12:30. Amen. Well, we got out early today. It's only 20 after. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 5. I want to give you this and I'll let it go. Here's a warning to you. Now, the remedy. Listen, this is real now. This really is real. It works. The remedy to you escaping temptation is the Word of God. It is. And you know what happened? God will have you read something that you didn't want to read. And you'll go, oh, why did I have to turn to that page? That is exactly what I was planning on doing. Ugh. But that's how it works. And I want you to notice that in the... Watch this now. This is why this Bible is hated. You know, I had a pastor tell me that another pastor that he knew... I know it wasn't a pastor. It was one of the people talking to me afterward. That a pastor said to somebody who had a King James Bible out and open, that pastor said, get that thing away from me. And he eased out of that room shaking. That pastor did. If you remember, several years ago, we had a family come over here from Illinois. He was a sort of a youth pastor part-time at an Assembly of God church over there in Illinois, right across the river. And he started using the King James. He was teaching kids on Wednesday night about the Bible and the differences between them. And the pastor kind of told him, he said, I think you ought to let that go. Well, one night, that man's sitting in his classroom on Wednesday night. He's getting his notes together. He's got his Bible out, King James. Pastor come in, looked at him, he said, I thought I told you to never use that again here in this church. And the man got his family out, and he said, we left that night. And they came over here. We laid hands on them, prayed for them. They're doing fine now. I think they moved up north, and they sing bluegrass, and they're just a good family. And they still follow us every now and then. But I'm telling you, there is a hatred toward the Word of God in this world right now. Devils do not like the Bible being around. You think they're afraid of a crucifix. They're not. You think if you hold a cross up, oh, that gets rid of all the devils. We hang crosses in every room in our house. They're in all the hospital rooms over here to keep all the devils out of the hospitals. Does that work? No. But one thing they do not have is the Word of God. Amen. The devils don't like it, and they retreat. The devil himself, the strongest evil angel that there is, the top evil angel, Satan himself, retreated in the presence of the Word of God. He left him alone for a season. He'll come back on you. You better watch out. 1 Corinthians 10, and we'll go. But with many of them, God was not well pleased. Now I'm going to ask you a question this morning. Is God pleased with you right now? For they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things were our examples, to the intent that we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted. You know, I'm trying to remember that story, and I was going to look it up and I forgot to, but there's a story in the Old Testament in the days of Moses while they're in the wilderness. And God was upset with the Israelites, and they all started to repent and turn to God, and revival was there, and people got zealous. Well, there was one of the men of Israel that had, a Babylonian woman or something like that, one of the Canaanite women or something like that. He had snuck her into the camp and snuck her into his tent. And he was in there laying with her in his tent, and a man went up to Moses and told him about it. Moses said, he's all yours. And that man went into that tent. While that man was laying with that woman, took a spear out, run it through the man and the woman both, and stuck them into the ground right there. And said, this is how God deals with adultery. See, your problem is, you're not scared enough. Sin gets easy for you because you're not scared enough. Well, let me tell you what God will do. He will make you scared sick. And when you get scared enough, you'll cut that nonsense off. God said, don't do what they did. Don't be idolaters, as were some of them, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Moses ended up making them drink the gold dust from their god that they had made as punishment. Neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and fell in one day. 23,000 people died in one day. No, I won't say it the way the Bible says. They fell. You know what that means in my mind? That day should not come except they falling away first. How would you, listen, watch this now, listen this to me. How would you like to be, you men, how would you like to be caught with another woman by the appearance of Jesus Christ in the air? That ought to make you shake. It's bad enough to think we might get caught by our wife or caught by somebody we know. How'd you like to get caught by Jesus appearing in the air and realizing, there went my chance? Neither murmur ye. Oh, no, neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed of serpents. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured and were destroyed of the destroyer. There it is, Brother George. Now all these things happened unto them for end samples. And they were written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world come. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. And I'm going to say to you this morning, if you're standing on a foundation of sin, you're going to fall if God loves you. If God loves you and means to save you and calls you to repent, he will let you fall so that he can pull you out of that mess, clean you up, and say, now, you don't want to do that again, do you? No, I don't want to do that again.